God ever had to take you through something that didn't feel good, but it was necessary for you to fully depend on God. We have the ability to choose to disobey God's will for our life. As a result, God deals with us, that God breaks us to get our attention so that we might choose to surrender. God bless Jacob. Jacob understood that although God had to break him to save him, his life was preserved.
Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. From this time forth and forevermore, from the rising of the sun to its going down, the Lord's name is to be praised. Our call to worship, Psalm 113, verses 1 through 3. Let us join our hearts and minds together as we approach the throne of grace. Oh, Heavenly Father, we come this morning just praising your name. Father, thanking you for all that you've done for us, giving us this opportunity to worship together in its virtual experience. Lord, that we might worship you in truth and in spirit. Father, we thank you for all those persons in our lives who blessed us, particularly those who are assigned as our mothers. Lord, we thank you for the ways that they've loved us, that they've nurtured us. Lord, they've provided all they have into our lives, Lord. So, Lord, we just thank you for all that you've done through others. And, Father, as we come to this moment of prayer, we also want to lift up those among us who are having difficult times. Our very own Doris Sims, Lord, who laid her husband to rest this past week. Give her strength. Lord, whisper sweet nothings in her ear that she may be comforted. Send people to her that they may be able to provide help and support. And, Lord, we just ask that you would just bless this church continually as it continues to try to reach out to everyone in this community, that we provide services, Lord, that we respond to your call on our lives, that you would do as we've been called to do. And, Lord, we ask, of course, a special blessing on our pastor, Dr. Donald D. Moore. Lord, continue to give him strength and power. Give him the wisdom to do what you've asked him to do. And Lord, we ask, of course, that you just bless all who are under the sound of my voice today, that they may have a special experience in this virtual worship time together. And these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning, Mount Carmel. It's such a fine morning today. We must thank you for being with us, particularly for those who are new to us. If you haven't experienced our virtual worship experience before, please leave your comments in the comments section on our social media platforms. We'd love to hear from you, and we will be certain to get back to you. There are several announcements we want to share with you. We're continuing to participate in Mental Health Awareness Month, the month of May. Please be aware of that. And of course, that special day today. Today is Mother's Day. And so as I noted in my prayer, we just want to say a great big I love you. My mom, if you're watching, I love you. And every mom, even those, and particularly those who stepped in the gap, who stood in the gap to mother a child who did not have a mother to mother them. Someone who always provided an opportunity, provided a shoulder to cry on, direction and wisdom. We just thank you for all that you do in our lives. Also, on May 17th is tax day. So if you haven't filed yet, please do that so that you will be current in your taxes. The 18th of May is primary election day. It's important. Elections have consequences. Elections have consequences. The last day to register a mail-in or absentee ballot is May 11th in Pennsylvania. So if you haven't done that yet, please do that as quickly as you can. We do not want you to use COVID as a reason for not voting. We don't want that to happen. Too many people died for the privilege. We also have some happy news to share with you. Our very own E. Paul Sandage, Trustee Emeritus E. Paul Sandage, celebrated his 98th birthday this past week. E. Paul is a giant among men. And for those who don't know, Mr. Sandage is a giant among realtors in this region. He's been a real estate broker, an accountant, an insurance salesman. He's done it all, and he's still doing it. And so we just want to continue to congratulate Brother Paul and all the good work that he's done, and his family who's been with him and supporting him and working with him and nurturing him. So happy birthday, Brother Paul. We also want to remind all of you to continue to tune in to our noonday and evening Bible studies on Wednesdays. Noonday is at 12 noon, evening Bible studies at 6 p.m. You can access the information by going to our website to get the details as to how best to access those two very, very important opportunities. Again, before I close this announcement segment, I just want to remind all of us that our tithes and offerings are important. You're contributing to the work of the church. You're supporting the outreach that's being done. You're feeding the hungry. You're providing clothing for those who are without. You're providing support for those college students who have no other way to make it through 4 years of college without our support. So we continue to encourage you to do that. So please drop off your envelopes, mail them to the office, or go to one of our social media platforms to use one of those opportunities to contribute to the church.
Beloved, this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. Well, as Reverend Woodson has already indicated, it is Mother's Day. And so from the bottom of my heart, I want to wish a heartfelt Mother's Day to all of those mothers who are celebrated on today. I especially want to give a shout out and a special Mother's Day to my mother, Shirley Moore, as me and my siblings call her, Shirley Moe. And also I want to wish a happy Mother's Day to all of those women who may have not birthed children, because we know that just birthing a child doesn't necessarily make you a mother. So, but for all of those women who have stepped in and filled in the gap, we salute you and commend you on this day. Want to make sure that you all spoil your mothers on today. Now, I don't know how it is in a COVID reality, but you all know under normal circumstances, you can't get a reservation anywhere in America on Mother's Day because mothers are just that special. So we salute you and we honor you and we celebrate you on Mother's Day. Well, I want to give kind of like an update. I know I watch the news, as many of you, and I see where the city of Philadelphia, the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, state of New Jersey, in particular South Jersey, they're all having these dates, or they've given dates on when they're going to open back up or expand capacity for indoor gatherings, indoor dinings, and things of that nature. And I want us to make sure that we understand that we're not confusing what elected officials and governmental officials are doing, what they feel to be in the best of public commerce, because that's not necessarily the same as the best in public interest. Because we have to keep in mind that in the city of Philadelphia, last time I checked, less than 30% of the city was vaccinated. In fact, the number was around 26 point some percent or 27%. Now, keep in mind, when Dr. Fauci originally was talking about a vaccine, they stated then, the CDC, that America would need to be at least 75% to 80% fully vaccinated to reopen. So if there's less than 30% vaccinated in the city of Philadelphia, and if disproportionately those that look like us are even less vaccinated, it would kind of be erroneous to assume that we should rush back in to public worship. So please know that I'm, like you, would like to resume public worship. We do have a committee on reopening together that's comprised of both trustees and deacons, but also we have medical doctors on there. We have individuals who are in the healthcare industry on this committee, and we're trying to make the best informed decision for Mount Carmel Baptist Church. Please don't confuse what other churches are doing. Some of the churches don't have the same situation that we have. Some churches have less members that they have to try to accommodate. Fortunately, we have a host of members. We have hundreds of members, and I'm grateful for that. And I am eager to get back into worship. I am eager to see each and every one of you. I am eager to have the sanctuary just full of a worshipful heart, attitude, and spirit. At the same time, we have to be intentional about making the right decisions and the best decisions, not only for Mount Carmel Baptist Church, but for every other individual outside the walls of the church that the individuals and members that will be inside the church come in contact with. So I promise you, Mount Carmel, we will continue to do the best thing we can do to make the right decision. Have we opened up for some community events? Yes. Many of you know we open up in partnership with the police department to do a gun buyback. And I just need you to understand, when we open up for events like that, it's not the same as a Sunday morning worship. We have a designated way for people to come in and a designated way for people to go out. During the gun buyback, there were less than 12 people in the church at one given time, and they were social distancing. So it's not the same as a Sunday morning worship. But I can let you know that we are working earnestly to resume with baptisms, as some have already called, and we're trying to schedule those. And we're also working in conjunction, myself, along with deacons and trustees, on resuming funerals here inside the church. I'll tell you up front, to do that will mean strict compliance to the protocols that we put in place. I'll say at the outset, whatever protocols we come up with to ensure safety, they are non-negotiable, because we're doing them in the best interest of safety and health while also trying to meet the needs of our beloved members during times of grief. So I promise you, we will get back to public worship. I promise you that we're doing everything we can to ensure that we make the best informed decisions, not for every church in the city of Philadelphia, but definitely make the best informed decision for Mount Carmel Baptist Church. And I pray that you all understand, and I pray that you all are in prayer with me and with the leadership as we make the best decisions. Well, on today, we will continue in our sermon series on divine encounters with God. Today, we're going to spend some time with Jacob as he encounters God at night, because you and I both know that those divine encounters with God can happen at different times in our lives, different seasons, different points, different circumstances may be going on in our lives. But nonetheless, divine encounters with God, or divine encounters with the presence of God, or divine encounters with Jesus the Christ, they are life changing. They may not always be comfortable, but they're life changing. May not always be pleasant, but they're life changing. May not come at the most opportune time, but they are life changing. So after the hymn of meditation, I am so eager and looking forward to share with you on our next sermon series, this divine encounter with God, as we encounter Jacob as he is broken to be blessed. I look forward to seeing you after the hymn of meditation. Beloved, we are truly thankful for being ushered into the attitude of worship on this morning. I ask that you turn your Bibles to the book of Genesis. Shouldn't be too hard to find. It's the first book of the Bible. I ask that you turn to chapter 32. I'm going to pick up at verse 22 down to verse 30. Genesis chapter 32, beginning at verse 22. That night, Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons, and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip, so that his hip was wrenched, and he wrestled with the man. The man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called this place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." For the next few minutes that are ours together, I want to preach to you from this sermonic thought: broken to be blessed. Broken to be blessed. Let us bow and pray. Oh God, I'm eternally grateful for this yet another opportunity to stand and proclaim your word. And so I ask that you do something for me that I cannot do for myself. And that is to send down the power of your Holy Spirit to give me everything I need to preach, teach with clarity of thought and of utterance. I ask, God, that your words become my words, that your thoughts become my thoughts. I ask that you consecrate me to thy service, thy grace divine. Let my soul look up with steadfast hope. Let my will be lost in thine. Amen. I've come to learn that there are some things we experience in life that in order to get the best out of them requires some force or some kind of disturbance in order for what's inside to be experienced or enjoyed to its fullest or optimal potential. Take, for instance, certain food items require a safety seal be broken first before you can safely consume what's inside the package. In fact, one of my favorite things to open up as a child were the biscuits in the blue cardboard can. You know, the ones where you had to first peel back the blue paper before the second and essential step of hitting the now exposed cardboard paper against the corner of the kitchen counter, which would result in the release of pressure, allowing for the biscuits to burst open. And understand, you had to peel back the paper first before hitting the can against the countertop, because I tried several times to open the can without peeling the paper back, but the can would not open without doing the first step first. Similar to that of a fire alarm in an office building where the sign indicates, in case of fire, break the glass first, then pull the handle. One thing for certain is this: in order to activate the alarm, the glass has to be broken first. This lets me know that sometimes in life, breaking can be a process or requires multiple steps or phases before you get or to experience what you're trying to experience. Now, I don't need to take a survey this morning to know that there are those watching and listening today who know all too well that life and life circumstances have a way of breaking you. And for you, your breaking is, was, or has been a process of breaking. And if we are honest today, you feel just like the can of biscuits, and you've been peeled back, exposed, and someone has taken you and hit you as hard as they could against the sharp edge of the kitchen counter. And I suggest that as we consider this text and the life of Jacob, some of us will see parts of us and our life in the text. Then some of us will see a lot of ourselves and our lives in the text. And because we do, in fact, see ourselves and connect with this text, many of us like connecting with the text around verse 27, when Jacob declares, "I ain't letting you go until you bless me." And we would rather just bypass all of the stuff leading up to the shout in the text. Why? Because many of us only want to be connected to the redeemed Jacob, the Jacob who is a walking example of existential benefactor of God's grace and mercy. Because the life of Jacob reminds us that we serve a God that is a redeemer. We serve a God that redeems, restores, and reconciles. We love the fact that God redeems what other people have counted out or discarded. And if we're honest, there's a part of our humanity that enjoys seeing the look on people's faces after a redemption story, but specifically and more importantly, our redemption story. And we love to shout over the redemption. However, I'd suggest there's a whole lot we need to connect with in this text before getting to the blessing, before getting to the shout. Now, in order to appreciate this text, we have to understand the historical context surrounding the text. Because I don't want to assume that everyone listening had or watching had perfect weekly Sunday school or Bible study attendance. So let's review for a few minutes the life and dynamics of the context framing our text, where we find Jacob experiencing a divine encounter with God. In our text, Jacob is on the move again, and he's trying to return back to the region he has left. But understand, he left because he was trying to escape a bad situation that he knowingly created between him and his brother Esau. And the truth is, these fraternal twins, Jacob and Esau, have been living out sibling rivalry in grand fashion since day one. And it begins in the womb when they were jockeying for position to see who would be born first, because they're fighting for position to see who would inherit essentially all of Canaan. Keep in mind, Canaan was referred to be a land flowing with milk and honey. So it would make sense for them to desire the land with all the resources. And history is recorded that Esau is born first, But Jacob is holding onto the heel of his brother Esau, which would have been as synchronous as possible. And from day one, there has been a palpable tension between of differences between the two brothers. Esau is a fighter and a hunter. Jacob is a conniving con man and a cheat. Jacob is a masterful manipulator. And Jacob manipulates his brother into selling his birthrights. He then tricks their father, Isaac, with the help of their mother, Rebekah, into blessing Jacob with the birthright, because it's the birthright which guarantees to whom the inheritance would belong. When Esau discovers what has taken place, he vows to kill Jacob. As a result, Jacob, the con man, with his mother's help, leaves and goes to his uncle Laban's house. And if you go back and follow the life of Jacob, at least Jacob is consistent, because he begins scheming and plotting on how to get over on his uncle Laban. As a result, Jacob and Laban have a falling out, leaving Jacob with the only one viable option, which is to go back to Canaan. The problem for Jacob is this: the last time he saw his brother Esau, the hunter, the fighter, Esau promised that he would kill Jacob. But he's out of options and he has to go back to the place he fears the most. And even after all of the mess and drama he has created, Jacob attempts to take or talk and scheme his way back into Canaan by sending his family and servants ahead of him in an effort to find sympathy in the eyes of his brother. And the Bible records in this 32nd chapter of Genesis, in the midst of all of this, when Jacob is alone, a man shows up at night and fights Jacob. As we continue to engage the text, I need for you to appreciate the fact that some Bible translations have subheadings for this passage of scripture, which reads, Jacob wrestles with an angel, while others have Jacob wrestles with God. Now, what I like about reading the text in different translations is that the nuances of the text are revealed. But it's equally clear that Jacob's encounter is not with some random person, but in fact, the presence of God. Because syntactically, the semantics used in the New King James Version text when referring to the man that Jacob is wrestling with, the man is spelled with a capital M and he is spelled with a capital H. But when referring to Jacob, he's referred to with a lowercase h. And we know that from reading this text that Jacob discovers that he's wrestling with God, which could be consistent with the use of the capital M when describing the man. So the man is God in human form, shows up and wrestles with Jacob. Understand, this isn't like Job's situation where God offers Job up to be tested by Satan. In the text, Jacob is afraid, all alone, and the text says God shows up in the middle of the night and fights with Jacob. Now, I don't know about you, beloved, but this is somewhat disturbing and an unsettling text, because it reveals a side of God that we don't see much or we like to talk about much. Understand, by the time we encounter Jacob in the text, some 20 to 25 years have passed. Jacob has a family trying to return back home, and seemingly out of nowhere, God shows up and starts a fight with Jacob. And this is not the God we are used to or the God we would prefer to encounter. We like the God who opens the windows of heaven and is pouring out blessings. We like the God who declares that, lo, I will be with you always, even until the end of the world. We like the God who Paul declares that nothing can separate us from. We like the God that gives us water from a rock in the middle of a desert. We like the God that opens up the Red Sea and destroys our enemies. And please understand, I understand, and I'm theologically aware, I'm Christologically astute and pneumatological sensitive to know and understand that God can, in fact, bless us without breaking us. But that's not this text. The God we encounter in this text comes at night while Jacob is alone, almost to suggest there was no intent to make this an easy fight. And there are a few things the text reveals about this divine encounter where God seemingly has to break Jacob in order to bless Jacob. But before I get to the points, there was a bonus observation in the text that parenthetically I feel is too good to pass over. The text says the fight occurred at night after Jacob had sent everyone and everything over to the other side. Understand, Jacob has been attached to people since day one. He grabs Esau's heel on day one. He's been attached to his mother who helped him steal the birthright. He's then connected to Laban, Leah, and Rachel with the mess he caused for 14 years. But now, after sending everyone and everything, God shows up to deal with Jacob. And here's the bonus observation in the text. Stop involving other people in your mess. Stop including people in your stuff who didn't sign up for your stuff. Stop taking people on emotional journeys because of your issues. Stop making people casualties or collateral damage because you have issues. But back to the text. The first thing the text reveals is this. I know we like to have support systems when we are going through things in life, but sometimes God needs to isolate you, not for you to be lonely, but so God can have you alone to work on you. As I engage the text, I question the text as to why God comes to Jacob at night and alone. And this is what I discovered. Sometimes God needs to remove any and all possible distractions in order to engage us in ways that at times might not be pretty. Some things we experience in life with God were never meant to be shared with other people. Here it is, beloved. Don't give a public face to a private fight. Sometimes it's best that only you and God are the only ones who knows what and who you're fighting. In your breaking, God is trying to talk to you, but you've got so many other conversations going on in your head that you can't hear God's voice. In your breaking, God is trying to lead you, but you're following the vice of so many other people that you're going in circles. The reason that some of your battles are private is because some of the things that God needs to fix in your life can't nobody help you with but God. But because you done gone around and involve anybody and everybody and then some, God now has to work around all of the non-essential personnel in your life to fix the problem. In the text, God comes at night and picks a fight with Jacob. But verse 25 of the text said something that was puzzling. When the man realized that he could not prevail against him, he touched his hip and broke it. The text says he, the man, could not defeat Jacob. Now, I don't know, or I know that I'm surrounded by a virtual sanctuary full of theologians, but this for me is somewhat disturbing. This for me is unsettling because we understand that he in the text, the man in the text, is God in human form, and the text says that he could not beat Jacob. Beloved, this is not the God we read about. This is not the God preached about and sang about. You've said, like I've said, our God can do anything but fail. We sang songs like a mighty fortress is our God. We proclaim that God is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. So how is it possible? How is it possible that Jacob was able to win? What can we do that seemingly on the same level or places us on the same level with God that results in God breaking Jacob's hip? How can our loving and caring and compassionate God touch us in ways that break us? Why would God touch us in ways that would break us? What kind of fight can God be in with us? What kind of back and forth struggle can the creation and the creator engage in, and the humanity of creation wins over the holiness of God? What is it that you and I can do under our individual human power, and it seems like we're standing tall as if we created the heavens and the earth? What is it that Jacob in particular struggled with back then and you and I struggle with today that even God has to wrestle with us? Beloved, the struggle Jacob had all his life was a struggle was that he always wanted what he wanted when he wanted. In other words, Jacob's biggest struggle and our struggle is to surrender our wants and our will to what God wants and God's will is for our life. We have to understand that in us, we have free will and we have the ability to make a choice. Jacob chose to do wrong. Jacob chose to be deceitful. You choose to be nasty and evil. You choose to talk about people like a dog. You choose to listen to gossip, then preach it like it's the gospel. Beloved, you choose everything. God says go right, you choose to go left. God said stand still,
you choose to run faster. God says, be silent. You choose to talk too much. God says, seek me first. You choose running after people instead of running after God. We have the ability to choose to disobey God's will for our life. As a result, God deals with us, that God breaks us to get our attention so that we might choose to surrender. Sometimes you have to understand that God loves us so much that God breaks us in the right place to get our attention. And for Jacob, he's on his way back to a place where he created some problems. But notice in this chapter, he's trying his old schemes to fix the problem that he created. He's still trying to manipulate things by sending people to soften Esau's heart. And it does not appear that Jacob has changed. And it's as if God confronts Jacob to deal with Jacob's issue. So in their struggle, as God is getting Jacob's attention, God touches Jacob in the right place, dislocates his hip, and Jacob goes from fighting God to simply holding on to God. And now that he is broken, all he can do is hold on to God. He can't walk. He has to hold on to God. He can't put any weight on that side of his leg. He has to hold on to God with everything he's got left. Everything he has, the only thing he can do now in his life is hold on to God. I know there's a few of y'all listening who know what I'm talking about. Has God ever had to break you? Has God ever had to get your attention? Has God ever had to step into your life, slap you upside your head just in order to fix your focus? Has God ever had to take you through something that didn't feel good, but it was necessary for you to fully depend on God? Which brings me to the second point of the text. The second thing the text revealed was this. God wrestles and breaks Jacob to take Jacob from relying on his ability to scheme and connive his way through life and develop his dependency on God. Now, I'll be honest, Reverend Woodson, I understood why God would come at night, but I could not understand why God would wrestle with Jacob, because Jacob was not a fighter. Esau was the fighter. Then the Holy Spirit told me, said, go back and read it again. The text didn't say God got into a fight with Jacob. The text said God wrestled with Jacob. And the reason I believe God wrestles with Jacob is because God always meets us at whatever level God finds us and takes us to where God wants us to be. The Bible declares in Psalm 18, with the pure, you will show yourself pure. With the devious, you will show yourself shrewd. Beloved, God meets us where we are. To Abraham, the man on a pilgrimage, God showed up as a traveler. To Joshua, the general, God showed up as a soldier. And because Jacob spent most of his life wrestling and grappling with Esau, Isaac, Laban, and even his wives, God comes to him as a wrestler. Now remember, it's night, and Jacob is anticipating Esau and 400 of his men. So it would be understandable that Jacob would think he's fighting an average man, but also understand that Jacob has a history of not recognizing God when God shows up, because it's back in chapter 28 in Genesis. Jacob said, surely God is in this place and I didn't know it. But in this instance, as Jacob wrestles and struggles, he realizes that this is not an average man, but God. And he recognizes this when his hip is broken. The text said that the man touched Jacob in his hip and it breaks. With one touch, Jacob realized that he was in a struggle with God, because no ordinary person, no ordinary man could have this kind of power but God. And it is here when Jacob realizes that his hip, or that he's been broken by God, and essentially says to God, well, God, at least if you're going to break me down, then you have to bless me. But keep in mind, back in Genesis chapter 28, God had already promised to bless Jacob by making his descendants great. But in this battle, it is as if Jacob is asking for a personal blessing. And he's so committed that he's not letting go until God blesses him. It's as if Jacob, for the first time in his life, Jacob is seeking nothing he's ever wanted before. Because in this instance, the blessing that Jacob now is seeking is different than all the other things Jacob wanted. Jacob always wanted things. He wanted a birthright. He wanted an inheritance. He wanted to marry Rachel. Jacob wanted life. Things, but he didn't necessarily want life. But all he wants now is to know the name of the man. Almost like Moses in Exodus when he said, who shall I say sent me? Moses was desiring to know God in a new way. So after the breaking, all Jacob wants now is to know God differently. Beloved,
Has God ever taken you through something at the end of it all? All you wanted to know was God differently? Your problem was your problem, but now you pray differently. You dealt with what you dealt with, but now your devotions are different. You went through what you went through, but now your worship is different. Your issues were your issues, but now your insight is different. The disaster was the disaster, but now your discernment is different. Which brings me to the third and final thing the text revealed to me. The third thing the text revealed is this. Sometimes God breaks us to fix embedded issues. It's clear based on everything in the text that more than anything, Jacob wanted the blessing of God in his life. And given his history, he should be commended for desiring and wanting God. But in order to obtain the blessing that Jacob seeks, Jacob first must face himself. This is why the man asked, "What's your name?" Keep in mind, the last time Jacob was asked this question was by his father Isaac. And in that instance, Jacob lied and said, "I am Esau, your firstborn." Now, I know I'm just a simple country boy, but I imagine that if God knew where to find Jacob in the middle of the night, that God certainly already knew his name. So I believe that the Lord didn't ask the question in order to get information. God was trying to see if Jacob was up to his old tricks of lying to himself, deceiving himself. God was trying to see if Jacob's character was still the same. So in the text, it's after the wrestling, it's after the breaking, it's after Jacob can't do anything but rely on God that the man asks, "What's your name?" And Jacob responds, "Jacob." It's after going through what he went through that he acknowledges who he is, which based on his name, he's a scheming, manipulating con man. And after all of that, the man said, "Your name now will be Israel." Beloved, God had to break Jacob in order to birth Israel. Jacob was a con man. Israel is touched by God. Jacob is a trickster. Israel seen God's face and lived to talk about it. Jacob is who you were. Israel is who you become. Jacob is now called Israel because he wrestled with God and man and he prevailed. But you have to understand, it wasn't Jacob that prevailed in the text. Israel prevailed over Jacob. Who he is now prevailed over who he was. Beloved, who you will become is greater than you were. The Bible declares in Haggai chapter 2, your latter will be greater than your past. I need for you to understand that this particular name change is unique in all the Bible. Because everywhere else, when God changes a name, that's the only name they are called moving forward. Don't believe me? It's in the book. When Sarai, she becomes Sarah. Abram becomes Abraham, Simon becomes Peter, and Saul becomes Paul. However, Jacob is changed to Israel, but there are times when Jacob is still used. When God is identifying himself over in the Gospel of Matthew, he declares, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." I know for the sake of brevity on Sundays, you think you are all Israel, but yet your neighbor only sees you as Israel. But you know, like I know, you still have some Jacob issues, some Jacob tendencies, and some Jacob mess still inside you. And the truth is, some of the things you used to do, you don't do anymore. And some of the things you used to do, you don't do as much anymore. But guess what, beloved? Even with the lingering issues, the Bible declares, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." So when you're not everything you can be, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." When you're struggling to get it right, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." When you make a mistake, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." When you fall down, "I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob." This is why Paul was saying, "What should separate us from the love of God? Absolutely nothing." Love it. I'm done. Remember I said earlier that most of the time when the text is read, people like to shout over, "I won't let you go until you bless me." But the truth is, God has already blessed Jacob, because in verse 26, the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." And we know that it is impossible for the humanity to see the face of God and live. So God in the form of man is saying, "Let me go so that you can live." But Jacob, in an act of disobedience, responds,
I ain't letting you go until you bless me. So God blesses Jacob so that he doesn't lose his life. God blesses him so he can survive. God blesses him so God can keep God's promise to make his name great. So, beloved, God blesses Jacob even though he's been disobedient. And if you've ever messed up and you know God has still blessed you, please understand this is what Big Mama would call God's grace and mercy all at one time. You don't know what? It was God's grace and mercy at all time. You're not what you should be, but God blessed you to save you. You didn't do what you were supposed to do, but God blessed you to save you. You didn't listen to what God was trying to tell you, but God blessed you to save you. And because God blessed Jacob, Jacob understood that although God had to break him to save him, his life was preserved. But understand something in this text. The Hebrew word for life in the text translates soul. So not only was his life spared, his soul was preserved. Now, remember, I said at the beginning, there's some things we experience in life that in order to get the best out of them require some force or some kind of disturbance in order for something to be experienced fully or realized. Well, in the text, Jacob is broken to be blessed. His life is spared. His soul is preserved. And after all of that, the text says, and Jacob called this place Peniel because he saw God and his life was preserved. Beloved, I don't know if you shouted all around your house, but I hope you shouted at home. Jacob is broken to be blessed. His life is spared. His soul is preserved. And after all of that, the text says, and Jacob called this place Peniel because he saw God and his life was preserved. In other words, beloved, I should have died, but I survived the struggle. I should have lost it, but I survived the struggle. I was all alone, but I survived the struggle. I should have been too broken to be blessed, but I survived the struggle. But not only did I survive the struggle, guess what? I'm still here. Beloved, I don't know about you, but I've come to learn how to thank God for surviving the struggle and still being here. If you survived the struggle, do me a favor. Type in the chat, Pastor, I'm still here. Because you're still here, let me testify on your behalf. On your behalf, I would say I've learned how to shout because I survived the struggle. Despite some things, I survived the struggle. Despite some people, I survived the struggle and I'm still here. If you knew the struggle I survived, if you knew all I went through, you would give God a high five on my behalf. But the truth is this, I know what God has done for me. Beloved, God has broken me and God has blessed me. In fact, God has blessed me exceedingly and abundantly above and beyond. And because God has blessed me, I will bless the Lord at all times. Because God has blessed me, I will lift my eyes towards the hills. Because God has blessed me, I will enter into his gates with thanksgiving. Because God has blessed me, I will enter into his courts with praise. Because God has blessed me, I will magnify the name of the Lord. Because God has blessed me, I will give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. And as long as I have breath in my lungs, as long as I have a heartbeat in my chest, as long as I have air in my lungs, I will give thanks unto the Lord. As long as I have breath in my lungs, I will give thanks to the Lord. Beloved, I'm done. The doors of the church are open for some man, some woman, some boy, some girl. You realize that you've been in a wrestling match with God. But I've stopped by my way to heaven to let you know that God is not wrestling with you just to simply break you down. God has been wrestling with you to get you to surrender to God's will for your life. Why don't you come? I'm giving you an invitation to accept the God in this text. I know it's not a typical shout because the brother in the text had to be broken. You may have to experience some brokenness in your life for God to take you where God has taken you. Why don't you come? The day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. This is the day that you get to decide virtually that you want to change your life, that you're tired of causing casualties in your life. You're tired of causing collateral damage in the lives of other people. You need God to work on you. Why don't you come? You may not be looking to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You may have already have a relationship with the God in this text. You need a church home. I'm telling you, I can't tell you no better place than Mount Carmel Baptist Church. You're just a family member that we haven't met yet. So even in your brokenness, we will work on God's behalf with you, be your brothers and sisters in Christ,
to help you be restored to everything God has called you on your life, why don't you come? Yesterday is a canceled check. Tomorrow is a promissory note. All you have is today. Why don't you come? This could be the last time you get a chance to even accept an invitation like this. Why don't you come? God bless you. Heaven smile upon you. I love you, and there's nothing you can do about it. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And all God's children said, amen.